Good afternoon to all of y'all. In this video, we wish to see the elliptical orbits of binary stars. Let us say there are two stars of mass M1 and M2, separated by a certain distance. Now we have shown the two stars as particles. We are assuming that each star, the mass of each star is concentrated at their respective center of mass. Now, if these two stars are separated by a certain distance, obviously there would be a gravitational force between them. The gravitational force by the Newton's law of gravitation is given by F is equal to G M1 M2 by d squared, where d is the distance between the two stars. The forces will be equal and opposite, and their line of action will be along the line joining the two particles. Now let us say the position of M1 with respect to the center of mass of the system is Ra with respect to the center of mass of the system, and for M2 the position is Rb with respect to the center of mass. Now this is position A and position B. Now from the basic definition of center of mass, we can say M1 Ra plus M2 Rb by M1 plus M2 is equal to RCM. However, we are measuring Ra and Rb with respect to the center of mass. That means we are choosing the center of mass as the origin. Therefore, RCM would be 0. If RCM is 0, we basically have M1 Ra is equal to minus M2 Rb. Now, from this equation, it is clear that the center of mass must lie between M1 and M2 because Ra and Rb have got opposite directions. So only if the center of mass is in between the two, Ra would be like this and Rb would be like this. Yeah? So it is very clear that the center of mass must be between the two stars, or the two stars must lie on either side of the center of mass. Yeah? The next thing is, if you take the magnitude of this, you get MaRa is equal to M2Rb. Now for a given mass of the stars, given masses M1 and M2, Ra and Rb are directly related. It means that when Ra is maximum, Rb will also be maximum. And when Ra is minimum, Rb will also be minimum. Yes? So let us bear this in mind. Next, what you would like to do is differentiate this. If you differentiate this, you will get the velocity of the two stars with respect to the center of mass. So you have M1 dRa by dt, which is Va, that is equal to minus M2 dRb by dt, which is Vb. Yeah? Va and Vb are velocities with respect to the center of mass. Why do we say this? Because the positions Ra and Rb are with respect to the center of mass. Therefore, the velocities are also with respect to the center of mass. A thing to be noted here is that this is the momentum of star, first star, and this is the momentum of the second star. The two momenta are equal and opposite. Or if you transfer this to the left hand side, you will get the momentum of the first star plus the momentum of the second star equal to zero. This is quite an expected result, because the linear momentum of any system is zero in the center of mass frame. The point to be noted here is that if VA is say in this direction, VB would be anti-parallel to it because of the negative sign. Another point to be noted here is that the two forces pass through the center of mass. Therefore, the torque of the two forces about the center of mass is zero. So, we can say torque about the CM of the two forces is zero. Now, torque we know is the rate of change of angular momentum about the same point, angular momentum about the center of mass. Since dLCM by dt is zero, we can say LCM is constant. That is, the angular momentum of the system of two particles about the center of mass is a constant. So we can write RA cross M1VA, this is the angular momentum of the first star with respect to center of mass, plus RB cross M2VB, that must be a constant. Now, this is the position vector RA. I am showing it here again. And this is RB. This is the center of mass. Now, if VA is always perpendicular to RA and VB is always perpendicular to RB, the path of the two stars will be circular. The radius will obviously be different. For the first star, the radius will be RA. For the second star, the radius will be RB. The center, their common center, would be the center of mass. However, if VA is not perpendicular to RA, but it makes some angle, but that angle is say not 0 or 180. Similarly, VB makes some angle with RB, and it makes some angle which is not 0 or 180, and it is not 90 either. Then the path would be elliptical. Of course, we are assuming that VA and VB are less than the escape velocity. If the velocities are equal to the escape velocity, then the path of the two particles will be parabolic. It will be an open curve. And if the velocities are greater than the escape velocity, the path will be hyperbolic. Again, an open curve. But if the velocities are less than the escape velocity, then the path will be a circle or an ellipse. When it is an ellipse, the center of mass will be a common focus. Let us see this aspect. Supposing this is one ellipse and this is the other ellipse. These are the two foci. We have shown the two foci. So these two foci will be common. So it's going to be like this. Now you must note here that we have made these two foci common and not these two, but these two. The reason being that when I draw the major axis here, when this particle M1 is at the one extreme, is at a maximum distance from the foci, the other particle also must be at a maximum distance from the foci, so that the foci is in between the two masses. Similarly, when the first particle is at a minimum distance, the second particle should also be at a minimum distance, so that again the center of mass is in between the two. So therefore, this is how the foci will have to be grouped. Now, let us say this distance is r1 and this distance is r2. This is for the first particle, first star. Then this distance, let it be r3, and let this distance be r4. Okay? The velocities at these points, let us say, are v1. This would be v2. Yes. This would be v3. And this would be v4. Yeah. R1 and R3 are the maximum distances from the foci. That is called as the apogee distance. That is called as the apogee distance. R2 and R4, R2 and R4 are the minimum distance from the foci, from the focus. That is called as the perigee distance. That's called as the perigee distance. If you see the sense of rotation, the first particle is rotating in the anti-clockwise sense. The second particle is also rotating in the anti-clockwise sense. Only then the two masses or the two stars can lie on either side of the focus, on either side of the center of mass. Now, what we wish to do is write the various equations connecting these velocities and distances and relate the velocity to the eccentricity of the ellipse. Let us see how we can do this. First of all, we have the basic relation m1 ra is equal to m2 rb. Okay, the magnitudes we have written. So, we can now write for the extreme positions, for the apogee positions, m1 r1 is equal to m2 r3. M1 r1 is equal to m2 into r3. And for the perigee distance, we can write m1 r2 is equal to m2 r4. Similarly, we can write for the velocities m1 v1 is equal to m2 v3 and m1 v2 is equal to m2 v4. Now we can conserve the angular momentum. We will write the angular momentum for the apogee positions and equate it to the angular momentum for the perigee positions. So for the apogee position, it will be r1 cross m1 v1. The angle at between the position vector and the velocity is 90 at the apogee and perigee positions. So sine 90 will be 1. So therefore, you will have r1 into m1 v1, that will be the angular momentum for the first star, plus r3 into m2 v3, that is for the second star. That will be equal to r2 m1 v2, this is for the perigee position, plus r4 into m2 v4. Now we can eliminate v2 and v3 and v4. we will eliminate V3 and V4 and have everything in terms of V1 and V2. We will use these equations. Similarly, we will eliminate R3 and R4. So we can now write R1 M1 V1 plus R3. R3 can be written as M1 R1 by M2. M1 R1 by M2 into M2 into V3. V3 can be written as M1 V1 by M2. M1 V1 by M2. Yes. 1 M2 cancels. Yes, 1 M2 cancel. And this will be equal to, let's write for this, R2. R2 M1 V2, I have left it as it is, plus R4. R4 is M1 R2 by M2. M1 R2 by M2 into M2 into V4. V4 is M1 V2 by M2. M1 V2 by M2. M2 again, 1 M2 will cancel. Now, we can take M1, V1, R1 common. We take M1, V1, R1 common. We will get 1 plus M1 by M2. 1 plus M1 by M2. That is equal to M1, V2, R2. M1, V2, R2 is common. M1, V2, R2 is common. Plus 1 by M1 by M2. So 1 M1 here cancels here. Now generally, in a 2-star system, 1 star is very massive. As in the case of the solar system, if you take the sun and the earth, the sun is very, very heavy compared to that of the earth. So, in such a situation, M2 is, say, much larger than M1. So, M1 by M2 would be negligible. M1 by M2 would be negligible. And you will have the relation V1 R1 or M1 V1 R1 is equal to M1 V2 R2. M1 of course cancels. Yes. So we are basically saying that the angular momentum of the heavy body is negligible. Yes. And you have a situation where the center of mass lies very close to the center of mass, center of the heavy body. So you have a situation like this, where you have M1 and M2 is massive, and this is R1 and this is R2. This is an elliptical orbit. Yes, the center of mass would be very close to M2. In fact, M2 would also be rotating, but we say it wobbles. We say a body wobbles when the center of rotation lies within that body. Because the center of mass is very close to the center of the second star, M2, M2 would wobble. But that wobble we are neglecting. That is why we are saying that the angular momentum is negligible. So, we have a system whereby you have a heavy star at the center and another star or a planet like Earth moving around it. Yes. Now, the next thing we would like to do is to conserve mechanical energy, because the only force that is acting is gravitational, and gravitational force is a conservative force. We can conserve mechanical energy. So the velocity here is V1, the velocity here is V2. So the mechanical energy at that point would be half M1 V1 squared minus G m1 m2 minus g m1 m2 by r1. That is the potential energy term, kinetic energy term and potential energy term. That is equal to half m1 v2 squared minus g m1 m2 by r2. Now we can substitute for v2 in terms of v1 from this equation. M1 we will cancel. So you have half m1 v1 squared minus half m1 v2 squared. V2 squared is v1 r1 by r2 the whole squared. V1 R1 by R2 the whole square. Now transfer this GMM term to the other side. We'll have GM1 M2 by R1 minus GM1 M2 by R2. Let us simplify this. Simplify this. Half m1 v1 squared would be common. Half m1 v1 squared is common. And you will have 1 minus r1 squared by r2 squared. Yes, 1 minus r1 squared by r2 squared. This would be gm1 m2 into 1 by r1 minus 1 by R2. So that gives us half M1 V1 squared into R2 squared minus R1 squared by R2 squared equal to GM1 M2 into R2 minus R1 by R1 R2. Yes. So you would have this one M1 cancelling here, one R2 would cancel. You can factorize this and cancel with this. You would have R2 plus R1 here. So you would have V1 squared is equal to 2R2 by R2 plus R1. 2R2 by R2 plus R1 into GM2 by R1 into GM2 by R1. Now let us write R1, R2, etc. in terms of the eccentricities. How do we write that? If you have an ellipse, and this is the foci which we are considering. This is the other foci. So this would be plus AE. Coordinate of this would be plus AE. This would be plus A. This would be minus A. And this would be minus AE. So we are considering this as the focus. If you are talking about the apogee, the apogee distance will be AE plus A. Or A plus AE, I'll say it as. Apogee distance would be A plus AE. The perigee distance, is going to be A minus AE. So, as a case, we could have R1 as the apogee distance and R2 as the perigee distance. So if we substitute this there, see what we get. 2R2. We have 2R2. So this will be 2 into A minus AE by R2 plus R1. R2 plus R1 is 2A. R2 plus R1 is 2A. And you will have GM2 by R1. A is common, 2 goes, A will go, and you have 1 minus E into GM2 by R1. Or you have V1 as square root of this and square root of this. Yes, A would also cancel here. You would have 1 minus E root of GM M2 by R1. If you had considered this as R2 as the apogee and R1 as the perigee, see what you would get. You would get V1 squared is equal to 2 R2. R2 is A plus AE by R2 plus R1. That would be 2A. And you will have GM2 by R1. 2 cancels here. A goes. And you have V1 is equal to root of 1 plus E root of GM2 by R1. Yeah. So, let us now interpret this. First of all, let us try to see what this term GM2 by GM2 by R1 is. GM2 by R1 is the orbital velocity for a circular path of radius R1. So, we can write V1 from this as root of 1 minus E into V0, where V0 is the orbital velocity for a circular orbit of radius R1, or V1 could be root of 1 plus E into V0, where V0 has the same significance. Now, let us see this 1 minus E and 1 plus E. Let us take the case where you have R1 as the apogee. So, if R1 is the apogee, the focus would be somewhere here because R1 is greater. So, this is R1. This is R1. R1 is the apogee and R2 is the perigee. And here you have the velocity V1. Now, you must see that this is the case when R1 is apogee. Correct? So, if R1 is the apogee, V1 would be less than the orbital velocity for circular orbit. Because 1 minus E is less than 1 and square root of that would be less than 1. So, V1 would be less than V0. So, when V1 is less than the orbital velocity for a circular orbit of radius R1, the position would be an apogee position. The position would be an apogee position. R2 would be the perigee position. On the other hand, if R2 is the apogee, the focus would be here. And this would again be R1 and this would be R2. Now we need to use this. R2 is the apogee. If R2 is the apogee, now V1 would be greater than V0. In this case, V1 was less than V0. And the case where the eccentricity is 0, the velocity, the orbital velocity will be equal to the orbital velocity for a circular orbit. Thank you.